'Tis the season to celebrate all things dark arts. So what better way than to take a look at some costumes from some of the darker characters in Harry Potter and the Cursed Child.
Villains are always great fun to be able to design because you can be a bit more edgy or experimental with it. Draco is quite a complex character because he's quite sharply dressed. So we always do very complex fittings.
So all of the costumes that we see are fitted very specifically to the actor.
Yeah.
So how long was that process?
So first the measurements, and then they do a rough version of it in canvas.
Okay.
You basically stand there and they pin it all together on you to see how it all works.
And every 2 weeks I'd go in and we'd have a new version
until finally you have what is seen before you, this work of pure beauty and delight.
Yeah.
It's very much my role to look at somebody and kind of look at the proportions of where the jackets might sit or the length of the school blazer cloaks to make somebody look younger. It's really important. It feels like the actors are wearing the clothes and the clothes aren't wearing the actors.
The amount of detail is sort of boggling. So I've actually built in a few moments on the stage where I will just have stand with my back to the audience just going, look at this. This is good. Just like, because so much work has gone into it, I'm like, I want the audience to get to see it.
So I combined a kind of frock coat with a waistcoat on top. So he's got quite a slim silhouette, but it's unusual and quite rigid in its form.
How long does it take you to get fully into costume, hair, makeup?
The wigs, makeup, and costume process takes about half an hour. It's just a slow accumulation of Draco.
That sounds like a great title. Yeah.
A slow accumulation. That's going to be my, it'll be my memoir. I tend not to put my final costume on until it's time for me to go up. And then I get up onto the stage and I'm not dressed until I have my wand.
So then it does feel like, and now I'm Draco.
Yeah, it's magic. It's scary and powerful.
With Umbridge, she's described as a sort of toad-like character, but also she loves cats, she loves pink. She's got this weird sort of femininity about her, which is sort of in contrast to the ruthlessness of her character.
So this is the first time that we're really displaying Umbridge.
People were sort of saying, just you wait till you see your costume. And nothing could prepare me for what it ultimately was.
There was something about the scale of her being slightly squat and round, but also she's got this voluptuous silhouette.
There's so much physically going on while you're on stage.
She is exaggerated, so there's a lot of reshaping of my body. It's like wearing a barrel of sponge.
I quite like the fact that she's got these little trottery-like feet and then this big silhouette.
So much thought has clearly gone into it. I mean, just the differences in texture from the fur to the velvet to wonderfully clashing colors between the orange and the pink.
She's got this university gown, but I put a bit of fur with it, so it feels a wee bit Tudor-esque. Then her hairstyle is combed and set into a Thatcher-like helmet.
That gorgeous head of hair, it is really something. Yeah. Dolores, I mean, she really knows how to tease.
Do you have a part of it that is a favorite piece?
Well, it would look gorgeous if you took the coat off because it's quite sensational underneath. And then it reveals the true gorgeousness of Dolores' shape. But unfortunately, I have to hide it with the surcoat.
I mean, it is a beautiful cape. And who knows, maybe
if the right person comes along, she might just do a little off the shoulder.
You just
never know.
That's as wild as she would get.
Dolores Umbridge has a flirtatious moment.
Yeah, I think it'd be marvelous.
I think it would be too.
Scorpius is this gorgeous character, actually, but he has an otherworldly quality about him in terms of his hair.
How much of the character came to you once you were wearing Scorpius's clothes and also the wig?
The wig felt like the biggest difference. You know, Scorpius, he is treated as somebody that's sort of difference. And then once you put this wig on and you look so different from everybody else on stage, it becomes impossible to escape.
Scorpius, I always saw him as very lanky and with very skinny legs, and he's geeky awkward, which I think is really lovable. So his silhouette I wanted to keep very sort of slim and gaunt.
There are costume changes that reflect character changes throughout the show. Is there anything that you feel physically changes about your performance as you're changing costumes?
Absolutely. Scorpius starts the show in this big robe. He kind of gets to hide behind it. And then in a moment where he sort of has to take the lead, he starts to wear this. And this allows him to kind of like grow into himself a little bit, and it forces you to stand up straight and sort of grow into that role.
I felt like it needed to be very military-esque, but I was also thinking about snakes. I was thinking about curved spines and the house colors. The house colors are important.
Can you tell us a little bit about what it's like to play a Slytherin?
It's been really fun. I love green, and we have a really cool new logo specific to the play. I do think we get the coolest clothes. You're very stylish if you're a Slytherin.
My logic was we were in the future now with Hogwarts, and that you get the chance to maybe be a bit more edgy.
If there is one piece of Scorpius that you could take and like wear out on the streets of New York, what would it be?
It's the hair. I already asked and they will not give it to me.
They won't?
No, they can't. They need it.
That's true, actually, yeah.
So with Snape, he was this blank, long, dark, shadowy character.
Stephen Spinella, can you talk a little bit about what it's like to step into the character of Snape and this costume?
The big thing about this guy is this cape is just so long, and now I've been doing it about 6 months. I'm finally at the place where I don't have to think about moving it all the time. And it's just like, flows.
Cloaks are a big language in the way that we tell the story. And, you know, Snape doesn't reveal too much on the surface, but when he moves, there's a sort of bigger presence. That was what I was playing with when I was designing his costumes.
It's just a great costume. It's got this, like, Roman vest thing here.
Yeah.
It's got a really sort of militarist cut and this sort of 19th century tails.
The collar's very high, very upright. There's a very sharp silhouette.
This is my Snape wand. He has two holsters. There's a longer holster if he's at a dinner party or something, and a short holster. So I'm ready for the next battle moment, not giving anything away.
No.
Through color, through silhouette, through hairstyles, you know, I wanted the audience to be able to really recognize the characters on stage.
Is there one piece that makes you feel like, now I'm Snape?
The wig does a lot of work, but you know, I mean, it all goes together, you know?
Yeah.
And then you bring whatever you're bringing to it, and once you're in it, you feel that already.